awesome to meet together once again. Amen. Let's go to the book of Matthew, chapter 12. You know, hopefully you've been setting up appointments at the GLC so that you could get some good time with brothers and sisters around the world. And if you don't know who to set up with, just go on Facebook, find someone from another church, and ask them if they would like to have a quiet time or lunch or dinner. Amen? But Errol told me that he called Blaze last week. And Blaze is our evangelist who oversees all the French-speaking nations in Africa. And so Errol tells him, hey, bro, can I get some time with you at the GLC? And Blaze says, no, I'm too busy. But we could talk right now. So Errol says, bro, I just have a question for you. How do you preach so passionately? And Blaze's response, not just changed Errol's life, but when he told me, it changed my life. He said, every time I go up to preach, I preach as if Jesus was coming back after the sermon. I go, wow, man, that's awesome. And I just take that as my conviction now. Every time I come up to preach, I want to preach as if Jesus was coming back after the sermon. Look in Matthew chapter 12. Come on, Caesar. Come on. We're with you, Caesar. Verse 39, Jesus says, a wicked and adulterous generation asks for a sign, but none will be given except the sign of the prophet Jonah. First, Jonah was 3 days and three nights in the belly of a huge fish, so the Son of Man will be 3 days and three nights in the heart of the earth. The men of Nineveh will stand up at the judgment with this generation and condemn it, for they repented at the preaching of Jonah. And now, something greater than Jonah is here. Isn't that amazing? The people listening to Jesus want a sign. Go, yeah, Jesus, you're preaching or whatnot, but I want a sign. And Jesus says, no sign's going to be given except Jonah. And what was Jonah? He was called to go preach, and then he hid. And God had a plan for him. Sometimes when we think God has a plan for us, it's always this thing in mind that we have that this is what I think God has in store for me. No, no, no. The Lord provides. But in Jonah's case, the Lord provided a well. And then the Lord provided him to be vomited onto dry land. And then when Jonah said, all right, God, I'm going to listen. Because once you're called by God, you're always called by God. So Jonah once again wants to receive God's call. And he gets told to go preach the same message that I told you to preach in the beginning. And what was the message? To repent. And what was the people's response? They repented. But some didn't. And it says right here, and I love this little line that Jesus says, some of the people did repent at Jonah's preaching. So what did this tell me? We are not just to preach as if Jesus was to come back, but you are to listen as if Jesus was to come back after the sermon. Because we are to repent at preaching. That's why we need preaching of the word. When we don't get the word preached to us in the morning by ourselves, when we don't get discipling times to get preached to, when we don't come to service to get preached to, we don't repent. But that's just a different mindset that the religious world has. Go to church to be encouraged, to hear some songs. And we're going to hear some awesome songs today by our brother Arrow and Dom. And Bethy's doing an awesome song for communion. But we're not just here to enjoy ourselves and to be encouraged and entertained. We're here to repent. Are you guys with me here? You ask, what are we to repent from? Well, let's pray and dive into the word and get excited about being changed by God. Amen? Let's hold hands as family and say a word of prayer. Father, we are so grateful to be again united in the Spirit, again united with even brothers that are visiting from Denver. Thank you so much for the encouragement of having them here. God, it's so amazing to see people stay faithful because we know it's possible. We know it's worth it. And I just pray that this morning's lesson really helps our hearts. It really helps us with whatever we're going through. And I pray that as we finish the book of Acts this morning, that we could gain convictions that will help us to the very end. We love you. Help us to be excited about your word. Help us to shake off, like Craig was saying, anything that could hinder us from having you speak to our hearts this morning. We love you and we dedicate this sermon in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Let's go to the book of Acts chapter 9. Now, if you haven't been with us the past few months, we've been going through our first principle series. And afterwards, we decided to go through the whole book of Acts. That's why midweeks have been a little longer, and we appreciate your patience. But we did study out last Wednesday how Paul was preaching so long that someone fell asleep and died. And so, remember the two things we learned? Don't be a clock watcher. That's why we took away the clock so that you don't see it. And don't fall asleep. Amen? So we gained that conviction? All right. But now we're closing out the book of Acts. We're going through chapter 22 to 28. So it's a lot to go through, but it'll be a great and exciting time. Acts 9, verse 15. We're going to be looking at how Paul had a destiny and how Paul was determined to fulfill his destiny and how Paul had divine guidance. And that's the title of the lesson. Destiny, determination, and divine guidance. There will be no points this morning. We will just be looking at these three things all throughout the eight chapters. Acts 9, verse 15. Says, the Lord said to Ananias, go, this man is my chosen instrument to proclaim my name to the Gentiles and their kings and to the people Israel. I will show him how he must suffer for my name. Now, this is awesome. Paul's conversion here. Because God tells Ananias, go to preach to Paul. How was Paul at these days? Killing Christians. And I don't know about you, but I enjoyed watching or seeing the good news email. How the guy at his almost gonna die says, God can't forgive me. I've done so much wrong. And then they study Paul's conversion. And they say, hey, look, this guy killed Christians. What was your sin again? Okay. God can use anybody. God can change anybody. God could forgive anybody. So he gets baptized. The next day, he dies. And he goes to glory. Paul's conversion, I love the way God set it up. Because he set it up so we could focus on one man. And we could see that that's God's plan for everyone. You see, for us, it's kind of hard to have friendships and relationships with a lot of people, right? That's why we're called to disciple only a few. Because if you try to disciple too many people, you will end up discipling nobody people. And so that's why God closes in and focuses on the story of Paul. Because just like he called Paul, just like he had a destiny for Paul, God also has a destiny for you. God is able to do that. We can't do that. God can have a relationship with all of us. And that's why you see in the Gospels, John go, I'm the beloved. He loves me. And that's why you see in John 11, people go, whoa, look how he loves Lazarus. I mean, Jesus could love everybody and have an intimate relationship. So that's how we know Paul had a destiny. But what was the destiny? Well, it says right here, verse 16, I will show him how he must suffer for my name. To be God's chosen instrument includes suffering. Again, so different than the religious world that preaches a prosperity gospel that if you just come, if you're close to God, everything will be okay. No, there will be suffering. But the difference is, as a Christian, how do you respond to that suffering? What are you learning? Because everyone's going to suffer. But are you going to allow the suffering to teach you to become a better Christian? Or is the suffering going to turn you into a bitter Christian? Because in Romans 5, it teaches us, suffering produces what? Perseverance. If you don't persevere, does that mean you don't suffer anymore? No, it just means you won't develop character and you won't get hope. And how many of us want hope? Then you gotta want the suffering and you gotta persevere through it so you could develop character as a Christian. Amen? Let's go to Acts 21. Now, of course, we already went through three sermons in the book of Acts. The first one was building a great church. You guys remember that? That was chapter 1 through 8. And then we went through chapters 9 through 15, and Fernando preached about forcefully advancing God's kingdom. Amen? And then we talked about this last time, turning the world upside down. Today, we'll be going through chapters 22 through 28. We'll pick it up in Acts 21, verse 17. So this is after Paul goes to Jerusalem. And in verse 17, says, when we arrived at Jerusalem, the brothers and sisters received us warmly. The next day, Paul and the rest of us went to see James, and all the elders were present. Paul greeted them and reported in detail what God had done among the Gentiles through his ministry. When they heard this, they praised God. Then they said to Paul, "You see, brother, how many thousands of Jews have believed, and all of them are zealous for the law. They have been informed that you teach all the Jews who live among the Gentiles to turn away from Moses, telling them not to circumcise their children or live according to their custom. What shall we do? They will certainly hear that you have come. So do we tell you? There are four men with us who have made a vow. Take these men, join in the purification rites, pay their expenses so that they can have their heads shaved. Then everyone will know that there is no truth in these reports about you, but that you yourself aren't living in obedience to the law." Okay, let's stop right here. First of all, it's kind of awesome to hear Paul go to Jerusalem. And remember, the kingdom started in Jerusalem. Peter opened the doors to the kingdom. And all the apostles were there. But now, none of the apostles are there. It's just James who's leading the church and the elders. What happened to all the apostles? They got scattered. They went on mission teams. Now take a look around. You take a look around at each other. All of us here will one day be scattered to another place. Isn't that not exciting? I mean, we saw our brother Jack, who prayed in Japanese. His desire is to be on the mission team to Japan. And he knows what's the cost. I mean, he told me, he goes, "Bro, I know there's going to be people getting killed out there in Japan and West China." And he goes, "You know what? Whatever it takes. First, I want to go as a tourist, but then I'm willing to go as a martyr." Amen. Pray for our brother Jack. Come on, Jack. But what's interesting here is, remember in Acts 15, they were all caught up on, hey, who's going to, should we be circumcised or not? And what was the decision? You don't need to be circumcised to be saved. But now that decision turned into something else. Now people are going, Paul's telling everyone not to listen to Moses. Twisting up the words. And you know what's interesting? Whenever you preach the word, people will twist up your words. They did it to Jesus. They're doing it to Paul. You know they're going to do it to you. Let's keep reading to see what happens here. Verse 26 says, the next day, Paul took the man and purified himself along with them. You see, Paul wanted to be above approach. Keep reading. Then he went to the temple to give notice of the day when the day of purification would end, and the offering would be made for each of them. When the 7 days were nearly over, some Jews from the province of Asia saw Paul at the temple. They stirred up the whole crowd and seized him, shouting, "Fellow Israelites, help us. This is the man who teaches everyone everywhere against our people and our law in this place. And besides, he has brought Greeks into the temple and defiled this holy place. They had previously seen Trophimus, the Ephesian, in the city with Paul and assumed that Paul had brought him into the temple." Verse 30, the whole city was aroused and the people came running from all directions, seizing Paul. They dragged him from the temple and immediately the gates were shut. While they were trying to kill him, news reached the commander of the Roman troops that the whole city of Jerusalem was in an uproar. He at once took some officers and soldiers and ran down to the crowd. When the rioters saw the commander and his soldiers, they stopped beating up Paul. The commander came up and arrested him and ordered him to be bound with two chains. Then he asked who he was and what he had done. Some in the crowd shouted one thing and some another. Since the commander could not get the truth because of the uproar, he ordered that Paul be taken into the barracks. When Paul reached the steps, the violence of the mob was so great, he had to be carried by the soldiers. The crowd that followed kept shouting, "Get rid of him!" As the soldiers were about to take Paul into the barracks, he asked the commander, "May I say something to you?" "Do you speak Greek?" he replied. "Aren't you the Egyptian who started a revolt and led 4,000 terrorists out into the wilderness some time ago?" Paul answered, "I'm a Jew from Tarsus in Cilicia, a citizen of no ordinary city. Please let me speak to the people." After receiving the commander's permission, Paul stood on the steps and motioned to the crowd. When they were all silent, he said to them in Aramaic, "Brothers and fathers, listen to my defense." Wow. story's already getting pretty intense, right? I mean, the whole book of Acts is intense, and hopefully you're fired up about going to the GLC and seeing all the sermons about the book of Acts. Manny's fired up about that, amen? But what was Paul here? We see all of it. We see that he had a destiny. What was his destiny? To preach the word. What else? To suffer through it. We see that he was determined. I mean, do you see Paul giving up after he gets beat up? Even after they say, hey, let him go. No. He goes, I am determined to preach the word. Let me speak to the people. But as we're going to see, he had divine guidance. He tells a story after this. We're not going to read all of it. But he tells his testimony, basically. And in Revelation 1, we see that we're going to overcome Satan by two things. By the blood of the Lamb and by the word of our testimony. A person who is not sharing their faith is not faithful to Jesus. Because that's what makes us disciples. We obey the word of God and we testify about Jesus. Now, after his sermon, look in verse 14. He's in the middle of his testimony. And remember Ananias went to go share with him and baptize him? Well, he's sharing his testimony in verse 14. Then he said, the God of our ancestors has chosen you to know his will and to see the righteous one and to hear words from his mouth. You will be his witness to all people about what you have seen and heard. And now what are you waiting for? Get up, be baptized, and wash your sins away, calling on his name. What's awesome about this? In the midst of Paul fulfilling his destiny, it began with becoming a baptized disciple. I mean, Jesus in Acts 9 came up to him and said, Paul, why are you persecuting me? Remember that? He goes, who are you, Lord? What's your plan for me? Go and meet Ananias. He will tell you what you must do. Divine guidance comes through people that God puts in your life. I mean, Jesus could have baptized Paul, but what kind of example would have that been for all of us? Jesus himself was baptized by John. Remember that? In Matthew 3, Jesus is like, baptize me, John. John's like, no way, Jesus. You need to baptize me. And Jesus goes, no, dude, if I tell you to baptize me, you baptize me. Yes, yes, sir. Baptizes him. Imagine Jesus didn't get baptized. What would people argue? Jesus didn't get baptized. Paul didn't get baptized. But yet we see, in order to fulfill your destiny, it starts at getting baptized. Now you need to ask yourself, are you delaying your baptism? Someone who postpones their baptism does not really understand what baptism is. There's a couple reasons people delay their baptism. Number one, oh, I'm just not ready. Well, have you ever made a disciple? Well, no. How would you know someone's ready? What's another? Well, I just still need to repent of some stuff. So you still want to be selfish. Because right here, when Peter preached, they repented and then they got baptized. So when people go, well, I need to do a little bit more studying first. Let me just read, you know, the whole Bible and then I'll see. No. Then you don't want to take the word of God and put it into practice. Baptism is not the end goal. It's not like, now that you're baptized, whoo, the job's done. It's the very beginning.
Come on, bro.
It's how you start. You're in the darkness and you enter the light. I got to ask you, have you fulfilled your destiny in becoming a disciple? Or did you fulfill it at one point and then dropped it and Jesus is calling you to pick it back up? Because guess what? Like Jonah, he has the same message for you. Let's keep reading. Chapter 23. Actually, we'll stay here. Verse 17. Gotta cut through the whole chapter here. Verse 17. When I returned to Jerusalem, well, where was he at? He was in Arabia. Remember, he went there in the book of Galatians. It speaks about how after Paul was baptized, he didn't want to meet with no man. He went to Arabia and walked with Jesus still for 3 years. And that's why he's called an apostle, like all the rest of them. But let's keep reading. Verse 17, when I came back to Jerusalem and was praying at the temple, you see, Paul had his quiet time. He fell into a trance. Okay, he had a crazy quiet time. Verse 18, I saw the Lord speaking to me. Quick, he said, leave Jerusalem immediately because the people here will not accept your testimony about me. Lord, I replied, these people know that I went from one synagogue to another to imprison and beat those who believe in you. And when the blood of your martyr Stephen was shed, I stood there giving my approval and guarding the clothes of those who were killing them. Then the Lord said to me, sorry, I wasn't aware of that. Go somewhere else. No, the Lord said, go. I will send you far away to the Gentiles. Wow. God tells him to go to places where he did not want to go. And that's often how God works. Go, man, I really don't want to go to that place. Well, guess what? You might be sent there. Or I really want to go there, and he might send you there. I mean, you never know where God's going to send you. But it's interesting. Where does he send them to? The brothers and sisters. How humbling is that? Paul used to kill these people. And now he needs to show up and say, hey, guys, I'm a disciple. And we know later on that they didn't accept him as a disciple at the beginning. They go, I don't know about this guy. He used to kill Christians. And we know Barnabas took him in. Barnabas says, no, guys, let's listen to him. But here's the thing that amazes me is that it takes humility to be a follower of God. Because how much humility did it take for Paul to go to those brothers and go, guys, I'm so sorry about what happened. How much more humbling would it be to be the church receiving him? How much forgiveness would it have to be? Could you imagine watching someone that might have killed your brother or your sister or your daughter or your father and then to accept them as a brother? I need to ask you, how fast are you to forgive people? Are you someone that forgives people quickly? And the most challenging scripture is forgive as the Lord forgave you. How did the Lord forgive you? Does he still hold a grudge against you? Quickly forgives because that's the only way we could fulfill our destiny. When we don't forgive each other, we stop ourselves from fulfilling the destiny God has for us. You were never promised that people aren't going to hurt you. You're promised the opposite, actually. When people fall asleep on you, you need to forgive them, right? We did the cross study. Jesus comes back from his prayer, sees the disciples sleeping. He goes, how could you guys be sleeping? This is a struggle. I need to go pray again. Come on, guys. And they fall asleep on him again. The people in your life will sin against you. But how fast are you to point out their sin and forgive them? Sometimes we want to point out their sin and we haven't forgiven them. That doesn't work. Try teaching somebody and you're angry. You're not helping them anymore. You're trying to portray your frustrations instead of helping this person get closer to God. But Paul had a destiny and you could tell he was determined. Let's look at his divine guidance. Chapter 22, verse 22. Chapter 22, verse 22. The crowd listened to Paul until he said this. Then they raised their voices and shouted, rid the earth of him. He is not fit to live. Now, what did he say that got him so ticked off? That God told them, go to the Gentiles. They had a selective hearing. They go, yeah, we're listening to you, Paul. Oh, I don't like this. I'm not going to listen. Sometimes that's how we could be as disciples. Or people in the world, they just go, you know, we call it the buffet of Christianity. You just take what you like. I kind of like the Psalms. It talks about how God's with me. Oh, I kind of like this. It talks about how I'm saved by believing. Yes, I like that, actually. It makes my life very comfortable. Repent or perish. Oh, no, I don't like that. These guys were listening to Paul until he said, the Lord told them to go to the Gentiles. Then they go, get rid of this man. You see that they did not repent at Paul's preaching? It actually, their hearts got exposed about how bitter they were. Get rid of this man. Do you think that happened because Paul said something? No, that exposed all the bitterness and hatred that was in their hearts. Let's keep reading. Verse 23. As they were shouting and throwing off their cloaks and flinging dust into the air, the commander ordered that Paul be taken into the barracks. He directed that he be flogged and interrogated in order to find out why the people were shouting at him. As they stretched him out to flog him, Paul said to the centurion standing there, is it legal for you to flog a Roman citizen who hasn't been found guilty? When the centurion heard this, he went to the commander and reported it. Well, what are you going to do? He asked. Well, this man is a Roman citizen? The commander went to Paul and asked, tell me, are you a Roman citizen? Yes, I am, he answered. Then the commander said, I had to pay a lot of money for my citizenship. Pa replied, I was born a citizen. Those who were about to interrogate him withdrew immediately. The commander himself was alarmed, and when he realized he had put Pa, a Roman citizen, in chains. Wow. Paul understood he was a Roman, born a Roman, for a reason. And sometimes we don't understand why God gives us things. Why we are born in a certain place. Why we have a skin color. Why we have a family that's the way they are. Why we are the way we are. Yet you don't know. God made you perfectly. The time you were born, the place you were born, how you were born. You go, I don't know, I don't really like the way I look. God made you like that for a reason. Maybe if you're a little more handsome, you would have been too prideful to be a disciple. Or maybe if you were not that handsome, you would have been too discouraged. You go, I wish I was just smarter and I could remember things more. Maybe if you were that smart, you would have been too prideful to be a disciple. You go, I got this. I know what I'm doing. You see, God puts you where you need to be. And for Paul, he was a Roman, and maybe he didn't understand that, but now he does. He goes, this is used for his destiny. And even though he had a destiny, he had to be determined to fulfill it. Now, was it right for them to flog him? Absolutely not. They flog on him. They're planning to flog him. They're planning to put him in chains. And the guys get a little nervous. You ever been there a little nervous? I don't know about you, but when I'm driving and I see a cop behind me, I always get nervous. Maybe doing everything right. I'm like, I have my seatbelt. Why am I nervous? You know, got my radio. I'm just like, because I don't want a ticket. This is how they feel right now. They're going, oh man, we did something wrong. Now, they want to fix it. So in chapter 23, let's keep looking. Verse 1. You guys with me here? Says, Paul looked straight at the Sanhedrin and said, my brothers, I have fulfilled my duty to God in all good conscience to this day. At this, the high priest Ananias ordered those standing near Paul to strike him in the mouth. Then Paul said to him, God will strike you, you whitewashed wall. You sit there to judge me according to the law, yet you yourself violate the law by commanding that I be struck. Those who were standing near Paul said, how dare you insult God's high priest? Paul replied, brothers, I didn't realize that he was a high priest. It is written, do not speak evil about the ruler of your people. And this kind of encourages me a bit. Not that he got struck in the mouth, but that he repented fast. Paul was not perfect, but he repented fast. I mean, he was a little angry and he acted on his emotions. I mean, probably you were too. You just, God, you strike you. That's not going to help anybody. But he acted on his emotions. And he messed up and got angry. But then someone comes up to him and goes, hey, dude, you know what the Bible says about this, man? You're right, brothers. I'm so sorry. Doesn't that warm your heart a little bit? Are you that fast to repent when people show you stuff? Because what made him repent? He remembers Exodus 22, 28. You're right. Whoever God puts in position, you need to respect. Now, obviously, this guy's not doing the right thing, but you still need to respect him. Paul gets slapped, but he apologizes. Sometimes we have a hard time apologizing, and yet you're the one that's in sin. Sometimes we have a hard time repenting, yet we cause our own sin. You guys with me here? Not only should we be fast to repent, but fast to forgive. Let's keep reading, verse 6. Then, Paul, knowing that's how some of them were, the Sadducees and the other Pharisees, they called out in the Sanhedrin, my brothers, I am a Pharisee descended from Pharisees. I stand on trial because of the hope of the resurrection of the dead. When he said this, a dispute broke out between the Pharisees and the Sadducees, and the assembly was divided. The Sadducees say there is no resurrection, and that there are neither angels nor spirits, but the Pharisees believe all these things. There was a great uproar, and some of the teachers of the law who were Pharisees stood up and argued vigorously. We find nothing wrong with this man, they said. What if a spirit and angel has spoken to him? The dispute became so violent that the commander was afraid Paul would be torn to pieces. He ordered the troops go down and take him away by force and bring him into the barracks. This is amazing here. Remember, Paul was also a Pharisee? He was a part of the sect of Judaism, which believes in the resurrection and angels and spirits. The Sadducees don't believe this. And so Paul, in his wisdom, goes, I'm going to preach about something that's going to divide them here. I'm going to preach about the resurrection. And all of a sudden, they're not attacking him. They're attacking each other. Why? Because they're not using God's word as the standard. You know why Christianity nowadays is so divided? Because they're not using the word of God as their standard. I know for me, I went to church all my life. I didn't go with my Bible, taking notes. I just saw the guy wearing a robe, and I go, man, he knows what he's talking about. Go, we have someone, special guest speaker. Man, he knows what he's talking about. I hope, and this is why if you look around in our church, we see the disciples, the members are not just listening to what I'm saying and go, yeah, he knows what he's talking about. No, no, no. If there's something I'm saying that's not coming from God's word, just bag it and forget about it. But if this is literally God's word, this is what we take and obey and put it into our lives. Amen? Now, Paul was smart because he knew what to preach to who he needs to preach to. This is how we love God with all our minds, right? We don't just love God with our hearts. We go, oh yeah, I love God because I feel great in my quiet time. Put the music on as I'm driving. I love God. I mean, I put it on my Facebook. I'm a Christian. I listen to the Christian radio station. I mean, I even went and watched God's Not Dead. And yet we are to love God with all our heart. I like that movie. There's nothing wrong with it. But we think we become Christians for other reasons instead of, you know what? I love God with my mind too. That means we watch our life and our doctrine. Have you been watching your doctrine? Because why do people fall away over doctrine? It's not because the Bible's confusing. The Bible's not confusing at all. It's because people struggle with sentimentality. They go, if the Bible says you need to repent and get baptized, what does that mean about infant baptism? It means it's a false teaching. Oh no, but I love people that are Catholics. Well, if you love them, then stay faithful and share with them. Don't water down God's truth so that they could be saved in your eyes. We want them to be saved when Jesus comes back, and he could come back after the sermon. Amen? Amen. Let's keep reading verse 11. Now, how do you think Paul feels right now, guys? He's been ordered to go taken down with the troops. Could you imagine that? You're preaching the word, and then all of a sudden, all these troops got you arrested. How do you think he feels? Probably a little scared, a little vulnerable. Let's read on. Verse 11. The following night, the Lord stood near Paul and said, take courage, as you have testified about me in Jerusalem, so you must also testify in Rome. Now, this is incredible right here. They can't come up with a case there in Jerusalem, so they send them to Rome. What's going to happen in Rome? Well, Rome is the most influential city with the most influential person. Caesar. And so even though he is going to be going through some suffering, what is it going to produce? An opportunity of a lifetime. And it's funny that he says, take courage. Why do you think God tells him, take courage? Because he probably lost courage. He probably was tempted. I mean, when somebody comes and tells you, don't worry, it's probably meaning because you're worrying. And so God's saying, take courage, because he was discouraged. I want you to gain the conviction, discouragement is sin. Discouragement about where you are financially is sin. Because we are to take God's discipline, not lightly, but don't lose heart. What is God trying to teach me through this? There's two ways we take on God's discipline. We go, oh man, I am where I am because of this person or that person. No, where you are in life is just the sum of the decisions you have made. The reason you are where you are is because you made the decisions you made. And that's what, at the end of time, you'll be judged on your life. Not on the church you were a part of, what your family was like, what your situation was like in the nation. No, it's going to be on your decisions. But that's a good thing. Because if you're the problem, guess what? You could be the solution as well. Amen? Let's keep reading. Verse 12. The next morning, some Jews formed a conspiracy and bound themselves with an oath to not eat and not drink until they killed Paul. I mean, they were serious about killing him. Verse 13, more than 40 men were involved in this plot. I mean, 40 people come together and say, guys, we're not going to eat until we kill Paul. Would you say they're pretty serious about killing him? Sometimes you could be radical about the wrong things. Let's keep reading. Verse 14, they went to the chief priests and the elders and said, we have taken a solemn oath not to eat anything until we kill Paul. Now then, you and the Sanhedrin petition the commander to bring them before you. On the pretext of wanting more accurate information about his case, we are ready to kill him before he gets here. But when the son of Paul's sister heard of this plot, he went into the barracks and told Paul. Then Paul called one of the centurions and asked, take this young man to the commander. He has something to tell him. So he took him to the commander. The centurion said, Paul, the prisoner sent for me and asked me to bring this young man to you because he has something to tell you. The commander took the young man by the hand, drew him aside and asked, what is it you want to tell me? He said, some Jews have agreed to ask you to bring Paul before the Sanhedrin tomorrow on the pretext of wanting more accurate information about him. Don't give in to them, because more than 40 of them are waiting in ambush for him. They have taken an oath not to eat or drink until they kill him. They're already there now, waiting for you to consent to their requests. The commander dismissed the young man with this warning. Don't tell anyone you reported this to me. Then he called of his centurions and ordered them, get ready a detachment of 200 soldiers, 70 horsemen, 200 spearmen to go to Caesarea at 9 tonight. Provide horses for Paul so that he may be taken safely to Governor Felix. Wow. Now 40 guys, hard line about killing Paul. And did they kill him? No. Because Paul had a destiny. He was determined, but guess what else? He had divine guidance. And I don't know about you, but do you think it was coincidence that the son of his sister was overhearing their conspiracy? I would say that's divine guidance. When you're going through a rough time, do you realize you have divine guidance and maybe God's putting you so you could go somewhere else? In this case, they're going to Governor Felix. And it wasn't by chance that Paul's nephew overheard that. They didn't end up killing him. So I don't know if to this day they didn't die. Or maybe they died of starvation because they didn't end up killing him. But it's encouraging to see that Paul was taken by 200 soldiers. Could you imagine that? In the verge of dying, and then all of a sudden, 200 spearmen, 70 horsemen, and 200 soldiers are provided so that Paul could get safely to Rome. That's how the Lord takes care of us. He didn't just kind of take care of us. He fully takes care of us. We're not going to read this, but the centurion writes a letter to the governor Felix. And look in verse 25, actually. He wrote a letter as follows. Claudius Lysias, to his excellency, Governor Felix. And we do have Felix with us this morning, amen? But this is Governor Felix. Let's see if his story lines up. Greetings. This man was seized by the Jews, and they were about to kill him. But I came with my troops and rescued him. Do you realize why he told, don't tell anybody you told me this? Wanted to take credit for himself. I came with my troops and rescued him. I had learned that he is a Roman citizen, and I wanted to know what they were accusing him of. So I brought him to the Sanhedrin. I found that the accusation had to do with questions about their law, but there was no charge against them that deserved death or imprisonment. When I was informed of a plot to be carried out against this man, I sent him to you at once. I also ordered his accusers to present to you their case against them. Jump down to chapter 24. So now he's going to be taken up before Felix and the most powerful lawyer at the time, Tutilius, wants to make a presentation for Paul. Let's read about it. Chapter 24, verse 5. So let some of your leaders come with me. And if the man has done anything wrong, they could press charges against him there. After spending 8 or 10 days with him, Felix went down to Caesarea. The next day he convened the court in order that Paul be brought before him. When Paul came in, the Jews who had come down from Jerusalem stood around him. They brought many serious charges against him, but they could not prove them. Then Paul made his defense. I have done nothing wrong against the Jewish law, or against the temple, or against Caesar. Festus,
wishing to do the Jews a favor, said to Paul, "Are you willing to go up to Jerusalem and stand trial before me there on these charges?" What do we see here? Paul had a destiny. And we read about it in chapter 24 while I was reading chapter 25. But we all make mistakes. Let's go to chapter 24. Verse 5. I was hoping you guys would back me up on this. This is not the right scripture. I got to hear something from you guys. Chapter 24, verse 5. You guys have your Bibles open? All right. 24, verse 5. "We have found this man to be a troublemaker, stirring up riots among the Jews all over the world." I mean, the whole world knew about Paul. Isn't that crazy? Let's keep reading. "He is a ringleader of the Nazarene sect and even tried to desecrate the temple, so we seized him. By examining him, yourself will be able to learn the truth about all these charges we are bringing against him. The other Jews joined in the accusation, asserting that these things were true. When the governor motioned for him to speak, Paul replied, 'I know that for a number of years you have been a judge over this nation, so I gladly will make my defense.'" The whole world knew Paul was determined. I mean, it even talks about right here, he says, this guy has been a troublemaker all over the world. The word troublemaker in the Greek is interesting. It means a plague or a pest. This guy's a plague. He's just infecting people. And he even got called a ringleader of the Nazarene sect. Basically, a cult. This guy is a cult leader of a cult. And it's just disgusting and it's a pest and it's troubling all over the world. When you stand up for the truth, there will be persecution. And sometimes we think, I just don't want to offend anybody. No, you're not offending people. You're sharing the gospel. Let's jump down to chapter 24. We're not going to read the whole defense he makes, but in verse 20, it says, "These who are here should state what crime they found in me when I stood before the Sanhedrin. Unless it was this one thing I shouted as I stood in their presence, it is concerning the resurrection of the dead that I am on trial before you today." Then Felix, who was well acquainted with the way, adjourned the proceedings. "When Lysia the commander comes," he said, "I will decide your case." He ordered the centurion to keep Paul under guard to give him some freedom and permit his friends to take care of his needs. Several days later, Felix came with his wife Drusilla, who was a Jewish. He sent for Paul and listened to him as he spoke about faith in Christ Jesus. As Paul talked about righteousness, self-control, and judgment to come, Felix was afraid and said, "That's enough for now. You may leave. When I find it convenient, I will send for you." At that same time, he was hoping that Paul would offer him a bribe. So he sent for him frequently and talked with him. When 2 years had passed, Felix was succeeded by Porcius Festus. But because Felix granted a favor to the Jews, he left Paul in prison. Wow. So we have this guy Felix, who was a high profile governor, and he married to Drusilla. Now Drusilla was actually very high profile in history. She left her husband to marry Felix. She's one of the three daughters. Do you guys remember in Acts 12 when the king did not worship God, so he died and was eaten by worms? Well, one of their daughters was Drusilla. Sisters are Marianne and Bernice, and we'll meet Bernice in a little bit. But she has her great uncle, Herod Antipas, who beheaded John the Baptist. So what kind of family line is she a part of? A wicked one. Her great grandpa, Herod the Great, was the one that killed all the babies of Bethlehem. She was reported actually to be a very beautiful woman that died in 79 AD. But this is kind of cool to even think about. This is what history records. So these are real people that are being shared with. Isn't that all exciting right there? Yeah. Now, I got to find it kind of humorous that Paul is in prison for 2 years. I mean, sometimes we get impatient with God's plan. God tells him, "You will go to Rome." But then all these things are happening on the way to Rome. And then for 2 years. But what's happening? Did the movement stop because he was in prison?
No.
I mean, you got to love those scriptures. It says, although Paul was in prison, the gospel kept bearing fruit all over the world. Now, Felix is being preached at. Did he repent? No. I mean, Paul's laying it out. He's talking about righteousness, self-control, about judgment. And then Felix gets a little afraid. Why? Probably because of his past and all of his family, that he goes, that's enough. When I find it convenient, I will come and speak to you. Now, I don't know if that time ever came, but this shows us something. Sometimes we want to hear the word of God conveniently. Sometimes we want to obey God conveniently. Well, if this fits into my schedule, if this fits into my life, if this fits into my job, then I'll put it into practice. If this is going to help my wife, awesome. If this is going to help my kids, incredible. But if this is going to challenge me and maybe put my kids at risk, or maybe put my situation at risk, or maybe get my job on the line, that's enough. Come back when it's convenient. That should not be our hearts. Because when you don't fulfill God's plan, you don't fulfill his destiny. Let's keep reading. Chapter 25, verse 1. It says, 3 days after arriving in the province, Festus went up to Caesarea, to Jerusalem, where the chief priests and the Jewish leaders appeared before him and presented the charges against Paul. They requested Festus as a favor to them to have Paul transferred to Jerusalem, for they were preparing an ambush to kill him on the way. Festus answered, Paul is being held at Caesarea, and I myself am going there soon. Let some of your leaders come with me. And if the man has done anything wrong, they can press charges for him there. Jump down to verse 13. A few days later, King Agrippa and Bernice arrived at Caesarea to pay their respects to Festus. Since they were spending many days there, Festus discussed Paul's case with the king. He said, there is a man here whom Felix left as a prisoner. When I went to Jerusalem, the chief priests and elders of the Jews brought these charges against him and asked that he could condemn him. You know what's interesting here? Is that King Agrippa and Bernice go and pay the respects to Festus. Who is King Agrippa? Well, he's actually the son of Herod, the one who got eaten by worms. He's the brother of Bernice, the brother of Josiah. Remember his three kids? Bernice married her uncle, Herod, king of Chukas, died quickly, and then she went to live with King Agrippa II and began an illicit affair with her blood brother. Do you see why these people are a little scared of the message? Because they're going, oh man, this totally condemns my lifestyle. And instead of, I could preach at repentance, they go, I don't like this message. But we go on, Bernice actually falls in love with Titus, the future emperor of Rome, and he's the one that destroyed all Jerusalem. Are you guys with me here? And Romans thought it was gross for him to do this. So uproar happened, and he didn't end up doing this. But all these people, we know from history, and they got a chance to become disciples. This just should give us a warmth in our heart. Everybody you meet should have a chance to be a disciple. I was convicted this past Wednesday, because on my way to midweek, there was a woman next to me who was kind of walking alongside me. And I'm getting ready for midweek, and I got to be praying and just looking through the lesson. And something inside of me goes, you should probably share with the person next to you here and invite her to midweek. And I made some excuses in my head. I go, well, I'm on my way to midweek. I don't want to be late. Well, I'm also praying to get my heart prepared for the sermon. And midweek is not really much of a focused visitor meeting. So I just kept walking. And then, totally forgot about it, but then I go to midweek. And Arrow's sharing for good news. And Arrow goes, you know, on my way to midweek, today I wanted to share with this woman. And I even smiled at her, was about to, but then I didn't. And then he said, you know, sometimes you could like make an excuse in your head on why you don't share with someone. He goes, I tried to, but I just couldn't come up with one. I just didn't. He said, I felt bad, so then I prayed, God, just help me to run into her again so that I could share with her. Well, he says, later on that day, right before he was going to come to midweek, He goes to Safeway, and who does he find but that same woman? And so he shares with her. She goes, absolutely. And you guys have a meeting today? Absolutely. And so she comes to midweek. She's fired up. And Severine actually led her first Bible study just a few days ago. So I go, wow, everyone deserves to be a disciple. Everyone should get a shot that you meet. Even if it's on the way to a meeting, even if it's in the elevator, they should get a shot. Because even that woman shared. She goes, you know, Errol, I saw you kind of smiling at me earlier in that day. I wasn't sure if you were going to say something, and you didn't. So I go, wow. I mean, how convicting was that for Errol? But how convicting was that for me hearing that on the way to midweek? Amen? But just like Paul repented, we could all repent as well. Amen? So let's go down to verse 23. So Festus gets a chance to hear Paul. And he's just amazed at Paul. So he goes, you guys gotta meet Paul. In chapter 25, verse 23, says the next day, Agrippa and Bernice came with the great pomp and entered the audience room with the high-ranking military officers and the prominent men of the city. At the command of Festus, Paul was brought in. Now, this is kind of cool because the Paul who's been in prison for 2 years now gets a chance to share with the king. He gets a chance to share with all the high leaders of this time. Verse 19. Chapter 26, sorry. 26, verse 19. So then, King Agrippa, I was not disobedient to the vision from heaven. First to those in Damascus, then to those in Jerusalem, and in all of Judea, and then to the Gentiles. I preached that they should repent and turn to God and demonstrate their repentance by their deeds. So opposite from what we hear, God knows my heart. No, we show our repentance by our deeds. Let's keep reading. That is why some Jews seized me in the temple courts and tried to kill me. But God has helped me to this very day. So I stand here and testify to small and great alike. I'm saying nothing beyond what the prophets and Moses said would happen, that the Messiah would suffer and as the first to rise from the dead would bring the message of light to his own people and to the Gentile. At this point, Festus interrupted Paul's defense. You are out of your mind. He shouted, your great learning is driving you insane. I'm not insane, most excellent Festus. Paul replied, what I'm saying is true and reasonable. The king is familiar with these things and I can speak freely to him. I'm convinced that none of this escaped his notice because it was done in a corner. King Agrippa, do you believe the prophets? I know you do. Then King Agrippa said to Paul, do you think that in such a short time you could persuade me to be a Christian? Paul replied, well, short time or long, I pray to God that not only you, but all of you who are listening to me today may become what I am. Well, except for these chains. The king rose, and with him the governor Bernice and those sitting with them. After they left the room, they began saying to one another, this man is not doing anything that deserves death or punishment. Agrippa said to Festus, this man could have been set free if he had not appealed to Caesar. He could have been let go and not gone through all this suffering, but why did he want to appeal to Caesar? Because remember, God told him, you must testify about me in Rome. You see, sometimes we get the call of God and we don't make it personal. We wait till people get into our lives. And there's that balance. Sometimes people go, well, no one's telling me to do anything, so I guess I'm not going to do anything. No, we've been given the charge by God to go make disciples. He didn't explicitly tell us how to do it. He just said, go. And whenever the people struggled in the Bible, what was Jesus' response? Go. Do you take God's call personal? That this is my job. If my Bible talk was the only one in Portland, how would we get the job done? Or do you get tricked out because you go, well, there's another Bible talk out there sharing. Well, we didn't have visitors, but I'm sure someone else had a visitor somewhere else. Sometimes we do that personally. Well, I know I don't have a visitor today, but someone else I'm sure is going to bring a visitor I can meet. I know I don't have any Bible studies, but I'm sure there's Bible studies going on. God knows my situation. This is why that's dangerous. Because then we start taking shortcuts. Paul could have totally took a shortcut right here. Oh man, I could be set free. Awesome. No, he goes, I must go and talk to Caesar. He had a destiny. He was determined to fulfill that destiny. And you could just totally see divine guidance all throughout his journey. He's had God's help along the way. Do you believe that in your life? There's one reason why we don't want to fulfill our destiny. We go, is God going to be with me? But look at what happened last week. No. God is sovereign. He's going to allow things to happen only to make us more effective for him. How do you respond to the things that God brings to your life? There's two ways. Either you're going to take it light and go, well, I guess this is just my life. Well, this is what God wants for me, to kind of just suffer. I'm just a poor, wayfaring stranger. Other people lose heart. Go, God is teaching me so much. We are to just go, you know what? Repent of self-pity. I am not the victim. I'm a son of God. I am a daughter of God. God is not punishing me. He's helping me fulfill my destiny. But are you determined to fulfill it? Do you realize you have divine guidance? I love Paul's preaching to King Agrippa because the message was so clear that King Agrippa goes, I know what you're trying to do here. You want me to become a Christian, don't you? Paul's like, yeah, I'm not hiding that. Like, I totally want you to. Matter of fact, I'll do anything for you to become a Christian. I want you to be just like me, except for these chains. Don't want you to be chained up right here. But is that your heart when you meet people? To persuade them. You know what the word persuade means? Because we know from 2 Corinthians 5, we fear the Lord. That's why we persuade. Persuade in the Greek means to twist someone's arm. And if you're Mexican, you know that because we play that growing up, right? El Indio. It just, and you're like, ah, it just burns. Don't, if you do it yourself, it doesn't burn. But try to have someone else do that. The Indian, yeah, it hurts. But no one's going to get mad at you in heaven. Why did you share with me? We know even Ananias needed to urge Paul. What are you doing, Paul? Get up and be baptized. Are you someone who urges people? Twists her arm if they have to. I love Charmel's heart at work because her first day at her job, she posts a picture of all her coworkers and says, meet all the future disciples I'm going to share with. I have to call her. I go, sis, that's probably not the best for coworkers to see that, but that's a great heart. And every time she shares, she goes, you know, I had a coworker out to church. I have Bible studies with my coworkers. She is literally just pulling the arms of people. Why? Because she fears the Lord. What stops us from wanting to do this? Maybe because you're not living it out. How can you, do you think Paul could be like, I want you to be like me if he wasn't living it out? We could sometimes feel hypocritical when we share because we're not living it out. But the answer is simple. Start to live it out. Does that mean you're not going to have shortcomings? No, absolutely you'll have shortcomings. But God will even use that to help those you're reaching out to. You go, hey, every time we study with someone, I go, dude, this is my struggle and I need you to keep me accountable for it. We're a family, and once you get baptized, it doesn't mean you become perfect. I know that was my struggle. When I was first baptized, I go, man, all the sins are in the past. And then you had your first temptation. Do you remember that? You go, oh, man, I'm still tempted. I almost got like mad at the brothers. Like, dude, I thought my sins were forgiven. Why am I getting temptations again? Dude, that's your sinful nature that's coming back. Use the Spirit to fight it. And that helps us. There's a reason why we didn't get baptized. And then as soon as you got baptized, you floated yourself to heaven. No, we're in the 40 days of the desert here. And we need to help each other, not just wander about aimlessly, but fight to keep as many faithful. Amen? Now, we're going to skip chapter 27, but he sails to Italy. And basically, Paul tells him, guys, we shouldn't sail right now. It's dangerous. And they don't listen to him. They go, dude, we're going to sail anyways. And Paul surrendered. He goes, hey, man, God's in control. He's going to teach all of us, even if I'm in the middle of it. Now, verse 21, chapter 27. I guess we're not skipping 27. We're skipping the beginning of 27. But verse 21. After they'd gone a long time without food, Paul stood up before them and said, man, you should have taken my advice not to sail from Crete. Then you would have spared yourselves this damage and loss. I mean, not taking advice only hurts yourself. Let's keep reading. But now, I urge you to keep up your courage, because not one of you will be lost. Only the ship will be destroyed. Last night, an angel of God, to whom I belong and whom I serve, stood beside me and said, "Don't be afraid, Paul." Again, he probably was a little afraid. "But don't be afraid, Paul. You must stand trial before Caesar." He had a destiny. "And God has graciously given you the lives of all who sail with you. So keep up your courage. For I have faith in God that it will happen just as he told me. Nevertheless, we must run aground on some island." This is what makes Paul an incredible man. Number one, he was just surrendered. The people didn't take advice. The ship is getting destroyed. But he's still crying out to God. How do you know that? Because he listened to God's voice. You ever thought about that? The prophets that argued with God, like Moses, he would go and complain, "Lord, your people just don't want to listen." But he was still talking with God. Struggling with God is okay, as long as you do it with God. Again, what does Israel mean? He who wrestles with God and wrestles with men, but overcome. Sometimes we try to come in here, we get discouraged because we didn't have the best week. Of course you didn't. We are wrestling. We're wrestling with ourselves. We're wrestling to stay righteous. We're wrestling to do what's good. We're wrestling to share and save as many as possible. We shouldn't come in here with the attitude of, "How you doing, bro? Good, I'm good. How are you? Good." No, we're strugglers. We're wrestlers. We're wrestlers with God. Sometimes we think because we have a suit on and we come to church on Sunday morning that we are here to take a seat and just give our contribution. Some don't even do that, but we should. Amen. But we're just here to give our contribution and just kind of be told the message and leave. No, we're wrestlers. We should have a wrestling Sunday service once. Everybody dresses up as wrestlers. That's scary, bro. And then it'll be in the fellowship, you won't be asking, "How are you doing, bro?" You're going to look at each other and be like, "Wow, we're wrestlers for the Lord. How's the fight going, bro? How's the fight going?" And yet, sometimes we forget this, so we think we need to be putting on a face for other people. It's just be real. For Paul, he's just real. He's just struggling, but he still went to God. And God told him, keep up your courage. And guess what? When you listen to God, then you have a message for other people. You ever felt like, "Oh, I just can't meet with people because I feel like I don't have a message"? Have a quiet time. Allow God to speak to you. When Satan tempted Jesus, how did Jesus respond? "I don't like you, Satan." No. "You're so mean. I'm going to go somewhere else." No, he responded with scriptures. And he got it from Deuteronomy 6, 7, and 8. And my conviction is Jesus must have just had a quiet time on Deuteronomy 6, 7, and 8. And Satan just kind of threw things at him. He goes, "Dude, Deuteronomy 6 says this. What about this?" "Well, Deuteronomy 7 says that. Deuteronomy 8 says that." He was filled with God's word, so he had a message for Satan. He had a message for his people. He had a message for the lost. To not be close to God is selfish because you're hurting other people. There are people who are dependent on us in this room. Do you believe that? We are the hope for Portland, guys. How do I know this? I don't see anybody else doing it. And we have a plan. But it's going to take men and women in this room to become wrestlers with God and believe. I love this verse, verse 26. I believe, all right, verse 25. I have faith in God that it will happen just as he told me. Nevertheless, we must run aground some island. Do you believe that? Everything God says, I have faith in God, it will happen as he said. But nevertheless, we must run aground on some island here in Portland. Amen. Or wherever he sends us. Let's go to chapter 28.
Come on, Caesar.
Verse 1. Last chapter here. Once safely on shore, we found out safely on shore. Whew, it must have felt good to go on shore. It says, we find out that the island was called Malta. The islanders showed us unusual kindness. They built a fire, welcomed us all because it was raining and cold. Paul gathered a pile of brushwood, and as he put it on the fire, a viper driven out by the heat fastened itself on his hand. When the islanders saw a snake hanging from his hand, they said to each other, "This man must be a murderer, for though he escaped from the sea, the goddess Justice has not allowed him to live." But Paul shook the snake off into the fire, and he suffered no ill effects. The people expected him to swell up and suddenly fall dead. But after waiting a long time and seeing nothing unusual happen to him, they changed their minds and said, "He's a god." What does this tell us about us? We're fickle. I mean, these guys, they see a snake jump on Paul, they go, "Oh man, he must be a murderer. God wants him dead." And then he kind of shakes the snake off, puts it in the fire, the snake dies, and they go, "Oh, never mind, he's a god." And then it says everyone changed their minds. You see how double-minded we could be sometimes? That just helps us see that we are fickle. Amen? But we're not going to keep reading, but Paul cures some of the people. And because he cures some of the people there, they get so fired up and they gave him all the supplies he needs. So that just shows you. He almost got bit by a snake, but what did that produce? That produced all the supplies that he needs to get to where he needs to go, which is where? Rome. Let's go to verse 16. He makes it to Rome. Verse 16. It says, "When we got to Rome," that's an awesome scripture after going through the journey of getting there, man. "When we got to Rome, Paul was allowed to live by himself with a soldier to guard him. 3 days later, he called together the local Jewish leaders. And when they had assembled, Paul said to him, 'My brothers, although I have nothing done against our people here, or against the custom of our ancestors, I was arrested in Jerusalem, handed over to the Romans. They examined me and wanted to release me because I was not guilty of any crime deserving death. The Jews objected, so I was compelled to make an appeal to Caesar. I certainly did not intend to bring any charge against my own people. For this reason, I've asked you to see and talk with you. It is because of the hope of Israel that I'm bound with this chain.' They replied, 'We have not received any letters from Judea concerning you, and none of our people who have come from there has reported or said anything bad about you. But we want to hear what your views are, for we know people everywhere are talking against this sect.'" Wow. Everyone is talking against what? The church. And you know what? That's a good thing, because that's how the world was evangelizing that day. Bad stuff was said about it. And in 2 Corinthians 1, it talks about how we are the scent of God. We are the aroma of God. And so for some people, it's going to smell disgusting. But for other people, like the scent of life. I don't know if you ever given our brother, where's he at? Felix. Give Felix a hug during the fellowship. His cologne smells like life, you know? It's just love. You got to give him a longer hug. It's a little weird the first couple times, but I got used to it. I go, when I'm going to hug Felix, there's a scent of... For some people, it might be that way. You go, oh, yes, a group of people that are keeping each other accountable. A group of people that are calling me to obey God. Yes. But for other people, that's disgust. I mean, that's brainwashing. And then they call you to do... That sounds like pressure to me. That's death. I'd rather die than go there. But we understand those who love God will be open to God's word. Amen? Now, what ends up happening, let's jump down to close out the book here in verse 30. He's in Rome, and verse 30 says, "For 2 whole years, Paul stayed there in his own rented house and welcomed all who came to see him. He proclaimed the kingdom of God and taught about the Lord Jesus with all boldness and without hindrance." Paul made it to Rome, and what did he do? He fulfilled his destiny. He preached to the kings, which is why he was called by God. Yes, he had to suffer through it, but he was determined to fulfill his destiny. And we see clearly he had divine guidance the entire way. And he preached about two things: the kingdom of God and Jesus Christ. Two separate things. Jesus Christ, his life, his teachings. But the kingdom of God is the example of those living it. Do you preach about the kingdom of God? Sometimes I get tripped up when I'm sharing my faith. I go, how can I help this person come? Because this is different. I already go to church. I already do a Bible study. I already been through that. I was talking to someone last week. They go, I don't believe in God. Why not? Well, I went to a summer camp. I didn't like it. there's something more. And that's the kingdom of God. To know that we could have a great fellowship of all nations and come together and love one another. It's beautiful to see a people committed to God. Not just people that are older, younger, married, single. It's great to have our teens ministry that are faithful to Jesus. They're on Ignite right now. That's awesome. But you know what's interesting? That the book of Acts just kind of closes in a weird way, doesn't it? Yeah. You would think it says, and this was the story of the apostles. Or like the rest of the books, you know? The book of Romans is grace and peace. Send our love to God. Be the glory forever and ever. Amen. But this one just kind of says, and he preached there with all boldness, without hindrance. Why? Because the book of Acts is not over. And we are to continue to live the book of Acts in our day. And so literally there is a new book written. And it starts with you obeying God. And God has his own book for you. And so the book of Acts is not over because the Acts is the Acts of the Holy Spirit. And last time I checked, the Holy Spirit is still working in his church. Amen? Let's close out with 2 Timothy 4. Paul stays in prison for 2 years and then he was released. And in his release, he begins to preach the word some more and then gets arrested one more time. And in 2 Timothy 4, these are the last words that Paul writes, the last book. And he closes in verse 6. And I want to close with this as we take our communion. It says, for I am already being poured out like a drink offering. The time for my departure is near. I fought the good fight. I finished the race. I kept the faith. Now, there is in store for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day. And not only to me, but also to all who have longed for his appearing. Paul didn't quit. And he sums up his life right here at the end of it. And history shows that Paul, when he was arrested, was beheaded in Rome. But I love the last words because I want this to be the way my life is summed up at the end of my life. Because Paul says, I did not give up the race. And someone once told me, I heard it said, you know, the Christian is a marathon, the Christian walk. So take your time. Don't get burnt out. I go, that is disgusting. The Christian walk is not a walk. It's a race. And it says, run in such a way as to win the prize. Sprint. And I made a decision. I'm going to sprint my way to heaven and to bring as many as possible so that I could say these words. And how are we going to make sure we could say these words at the end of our life? Can you say it today? Keep this heart every day and you'll be sure to have it at the end of your life. Then I fought the good fight. That I finished the race, that I kept the faith, because the faith is so precious. And like Paul tells us in the chapter before, some have shipwrecked their faith. Don't be one of them. People will go from faith, hope, and love and turn to meaningless talk. But I pray that us here could be the people that keep the faith. Because I don't know about you, there's nothing like going to sleep at night tired knowing you did the Lord's work. Yeah. There's nothing like hitting the bed at night and going, I preached the word today. I ran the race today. I kept the faith today. And there is in store for me that crown of righteousness, which comes to not just Paul, but to all who long for his appearing. And I pray that today you listen as if Jesus was coming back, because that is longing for his appearing. God did not just have a destiny for Paul. He has a destiny for you. He didn't just have divine guidance for Paul. He has divine guidance for you. But the question is, will we be determined to fulfill our destiny? Let's have a great time at the GLC. I love you guys. Let's say a word of prayer for the communion. Father, thank you.